Hello guys, so today we're doing another portrait, this time a bit different. The colors, I feel like the color scheme that I actually use are a little bit more limited. Basically just adding blacks and tones of it, also some blues, hint of yellow, just a very light yellow. It has some green. I've been using my really not so clean palette that I've been using with everything else, so that's what's going on. And here I use a color pencil for the sketch, very light, you can hardly see it, but I am sketching. I'm just doing like the face, the form, just locating where the eyes is. Right now I'm locating the nose, I'm also locating the mouth. I think that's like the simple shape of a face, and I think that's the easiest thing to do on a portrait. The reason that I wanted to do this way is because sometimes I just start painting from scratch with the actual brush and not really show how to draw. I feel like you really don't need to know how to draw. If you would like to just paint a portrait, you can definitely use Photoshop or use anything that you can use for to do a painting. You can also transfer images these days. You can print from online a picture and transfer the image to the watercolor, which is simple and simpler than the actual drawing. I also think that sometimes we complicate ourselves a little bit when it comes to painting, so I will not want you to feel that you have to be in an advanced position for you to follow my tutorial or my demos. Just mainly focus on how the form and shape of whatever I'm doing, it's basically transpiring in the painting. I'm also using, for now I'm using for the bigger washes, I started with a yellow, with a sepia, and I'm using the biggest brush that I could find where I can just do and automatically just put down where I see shadow. And I think from there, it's basically a good map. It will guide me to do the rest of the portrait. I believe that this method can be also used when you're doing oil paint. I dabble a little bit in oils, and I use the same method when in the beginning, of course. Although, of course, I feel like with oils, adding that white paint and the other colors is tad different because it's is more texture than with watercolors. Again, I feel like this is something that I questioned myself as well when I was painting in the beginning, when I follow portraits or artists that I actually admired, copying from the old masters or whatever you want to call it, whatever it is that sometimes we do when we're starting, is that I kept asking what formula to use for skin tones. And it was very frustrating because I couldn't find a specific formula. And the reason is because there isn't. There's not a specific formula for skin tones. And you should not always rely on having specific skin tone formula. I know this sounds backwards and forward, but you should not rely on certain colors to do portraits. The reason why is because that will just limit you as to how many colors you can actually use on a portrait. I say, when I look at people and I wanted to do portraits, or I want to do portraits, I see them as colorful. So try to do portraits with different colors and experiment with different tones. Right now, I added sepia. I believe there was a mixture of blackish color in it and also a blue hint, and that's what you have here. I like sepia a lot because it's a warmer tone, and that's what I wanted to convey in the portrait, but you can use any other color. You can use yellow ochre, you can do burnt amber, whatever it is that you feel that is a warmer tone. That's what I wanted to do when I was creating the painting, a warmer tone for this portrait. For this specific portrait, I wanted a warmer tone. And about tones and warmth and cool, etc., it has to do with something very simple. One thing that I don't think I have mentioned in my past videos is that in order for you to know how to mix colors and how to do this and color here and do this, specifically if you're a flower painter, you need to learn your, tertiary, I don't know if I'm saying it right, primary colors, secondary colors. You need to know what goes with what. Mixing of color is so, so, so important. So we're basically, you're going back to a graph that usually you have to learn it by memory in order for you to really dig down into coloring. I think that helped me. Once I learned how to mix color, that helped me in my painting journey 150%, because I was able to mix in color without worrying if they're actually going to look okay. A big issue for me as well was the background color. Like, what background color should I add? It depends. It depends what you want to do. You're not always required a background color, especially with portraits. I feel like the best portraits that I've seen in watercolor, they don't come with actually a background color. I think watercolor, specifically when it comes to nudes and also when it comes to portraits, you know, some people like to add the background color and some people don't. And in this case, I didn't want to add no color whatsoever because I really wanted to just focus on the portrait. And so I left the paper, most of the paper, white in this case. Okay, so I'm actually looking for the tertiary colors. And that's what I'm basically doing here. And for me, this is also, of course, I believe that, you know, I'm still learning. This is my process of learning. And like I said, my palette, my watercolor palette is not like the cleanest. I have plenty of different colors here. But I am actually using tertiary colors. And this is done by mixing primary colors and secondary colors. And then you get that, the tertiary colors. It's very interesting to watch it actually perform into a watercolor painting. Also, I would not limit myself to just using one tone, but more like in this case, I use washes over the combination of these tertiary colors, and I also added black color into my paintings, or I better say I added black to the shadow. I am also showing here how to do the ears, and again I'm using my Samsung. I'm still using my Samsung. I put the camcorder or the camera that I bought to charge. Hopefully I'll be able to do this soon, see how it looks. I also try my iPhone, but the iPhone that I'm using is from actually the company that I work for, and I can really use it to do the videos, even though when I took one small, like maybe 5 second video or 10 second video, I noticed a big difference in the color. You could really see crisp watercolor scheme in there. And you know, I'm looking forward to changing my phone soon. So for now, I know this sounds and it sucks, But this is what I'm using. The good thing is that I actually found a really, really good a phone stand that actually comes in with a, this one I didn't got it with the LED light. I'm going to try and get a LED light for it later on. You can actually use it for an iPhone, and you can use it for a other for other phones, and it comes with an attachment that you can bend the tip of it. So I'm very, very, very happy that I made, you know, the not the sacrifice, but at least I got that out of the way. I've been wanting a really good phone stand for a while, and I've been suffering because the ones that Walmart sell is like the $35 one. It's really not, it wasn't a big deal. And I know a lot of people use books and stuff like that, but it was, I couldn't do it. I don't know why. It's just, it never worked for me. So I'm just now, thank God, I'm using the phone stand. So I'm just very happy that I'm able to actually just give you guys my front view, which is actually right in front of me. You're having my view. I'm not, like, I feel like if when you're having the phone right in front of you and people can see exactly what you're doing, I feel like people can actually learn that way. I'm sorry, you're gonna see my hair in there. And I was explaining here, actually, that to pick up with the brush, I know that's something that is not easy to do. And also the scrubbing part, like a lot of people are scared of scrubbing because they feel like, oh, I'm breaking the paper. As long as you're gentle, you can scrub away. I feel like, you know, lifting up with the brush and picking up with the brush, it should be like some sort of art form already, because you're gonna be doing mistakes. That's what I'm trying to do. Another thing that I do not do, and I've seen a lot of people, and I'm like a bit like, oh my God, why, how can I do that? A lot of artists, I don't paint to make things pretty. I paint in this case specifically in this specific case, I just wanted to sketch and try my best to do some sort of likeness and to look like a portrait. So this is not about this person or this portrait to look pretty or aesthetically pleasing. I wanted to perform or to do a portrait and not really a beautiful person. I just wanted to do a person. I feel like that's how you learn how to do actual portraits of people. Not to do it aesthetically pleasing. It's the same thing if you focus too much into details. And I hope that I'm not, I hope that I'm explaining myself. I don't want to sound like, oh, you know, but the truth is that I've seen people doing things the other way around. Like I see outlining right away the eyes and doing this and doing that, and this is not the case here. So what I do is that I'm starting the portrait all over. The eyes for me are basically the last thing that I actually do, and I paint the whole area, like the whole face I painted at the same time. And I also pick up with my brush whatever, you know, speck of bubble of water socket that I see. I don't have a problem with picking up with my brush. I, like I said, I'm a bit picky with the napkin and picking up with the napkin because I feel like it leaves some texture into it. So, not so much. I also have a thing with the blow dryer because the blow dryer, I feel like evaporates. Maybe I'm wrong. I feel like it messes up with the watercolor. So I try to be, I'm as less is best. I think the less you twinkle with the watercolor. You know, I feel like watercolor is a very not strict medium, but also a very gentle medium. So you shouldn't be, like, I feel you shouldn't be manipulating too much. Also because of the paper that I'm using is a 98 pound. It's not like, a hard or a rough paper. It's a very light paper that is basically used for mixed media or for sketching. So I'm using it for, and I'm adding a lot of washes, as you can see. And the reason why I did this is because, of course, I'm not only trying out and using the paper, but also to show you guys that you can do layers over layers on any type of paper, as long as you know how to maneuver the water content on your brush and the water content that you're adding to your paper. And so this is what I'm trying to do here. Everything, I feel like every time you paint and every time you do something, it's like you're studying, you're studying, you're doing research on not only the materials that you have, but also things that you can do new. I was a little bit concerned because I was actually scraping off. I was really rough with the paper and it did not break. Nothing happened. And I just continuing moving on with the demo. So here, I added a hint of that orangey red. It's vermilion red, I believe it is. The reason that I did that was because the model had blush in it. She has makeup and fake eyelashes and also eyebrows. And that's one thing that is a big deal for us artists. If we're doing a person, we can just like, it's just awful to do a fake eyelashes. It just doesn't go well in a painting. So I will suggest if that was the case of someone wearing those things, don't focus on the details. Forget about the eyelashes. Don't even go there, because if you focus on every single eyelash, you'll be there like forever. You won't be able to, like, tackling something is like that is difficult, especially if you're painting. And like we said, we're trying to make a portrait here, not really aesthetically anything pleasing here. I scrub with my finger, I took off with my brush, I spit the painting, I abused, I did all kinds of things. What I'm trying to say is that you do everything possible in your hands to do the things right. One thing that I also was adding that the line parts, like lines and details, I try to omit as much as I could. I went again, you go with shadow form, and that's what I'm trying to do here. I also want to just, I don't know if you noticed, but I'm also trying my best to switch back and forth into different washes as well as the different brushes that you use. And if you notice that I am doing the whole face, I'm not resting, I'm not waiting for the paper to dry, I'm just going around. I think the practice makes it better, and as much as you continue practicing, you'll be able to kind of know where the which way, which patches of watercolor are actually dry. You can always feel it with your pinky and see where things are drying up, and you can continue to add water. That's one thing that I think that desperates everybody, because watercolor just takes time to dry. And of course, it's not easy, but a bigger painting like this, it will actually allow you to add more washes along the way. Another thing that watercolor, I feel like that people don't like is the splashes. Sometimes that mushroom effect when it's a lot of water, when there is a lot of water in it. I'll say don't worry about it. You can always add a hint of a bit of water, let it dry, and then you add more watercolor, a little drier watercolor, and it should be good. I feel like when you make mistakes, that's how you learn. So don't focus too much on trying to make things perfect, because I feel like that's a bit frustrating for anybody that is learning, and also for people that already have enough years doing this. I did add a hint of yellow because her face actually had yellow tone in it. And then after I added the yellow, I felt like, you know what, this is just not working for me. My watercolor here is really not. My painting is more towards some warmer colors, so I have to take part of that yellow. I continue to add more darker tone on each corner of the hair, and I'm also lifting up whatever I feel like, you know what, this gotta go. Also, I want you to understand that this is a human being, so anatomy plays a big part, and I feel like you should also corroborate and start studying if you have the opportunity and chance. I'm so grateful and so I don't know, like everything just came at the right time. I had a friend who actually went to an academy where with a great teacher, anatomy teacher, and he was able to pass on to me every single video of that life class, and that helped me to develop a keen eye when it comes to anatomy and how to accommodate the skeleton and how to accommodate the eye sockets and the shadow and all that stuff. And later on, I also practice with other artists because I feel like that's the best way to actually learn on how to what shadow goes. Like you have to know that if it's a muscle, it's a little pinkish because the muscle is that's the color of the muscle, right? So if it's also a shadow underneath, you know, you have blood vessels, you have cartilage, you have all kinds of things, not only on the face, also on the hands. So that plays a big part when it comes to doing portraits. And so I'm just grateful and thankful that I was able to pay attention to those mini videos that he passed on to me that actually really helped me. And I wish one day I could actually sit down with him and say thank you because it actually teach me so much. And everything that I know now, I actually gotten to know because of his kindness that he allowed me to actually look at his classes that he was actually basically paying for them, and I got them for free. And he got everything, like he said, you know, I really want to help you. I think that, you know, this can help you, and this is the classes that I'm taking. And he gave me the CDs, and from there I also started helping myself to learn. I am actually not a, like, I would like to say I'm halfway. I'm not a professional artist. Like, I have never gotten to university except I went to, in Philadelphia, I went to a small class of botanical and for drawing because that was in the beginning, and that's basically my, like, the closest to. I also have had a lot of classes with different individuals, artists that I admire, that I feel like, you know, I really want to learn from this person. Videos of different people, how they approach their style and how they do the style. I don't have a problem, and I feel like that's so great that we have a vast variety of people that we can actually choose from, and we can actually copy from and learn from. So if you ever have a chance to learn from someone, I know a lot of artists go on to Patreon and they patronize themselves, or not patronize themselves, but ask to for them to when they want to give you like their details and stuff like they do, they go on to Patreon and people can get their videos, which is actually absolutely amazing. And believe me, we do. People do learn from those. So that's basically also the way I learned different things. I think that for me, watercolor is just the beginning, and you should not limit yourself to just do watercolors. I feel like watercolor should be like the medium of choice when it comes to sketching and also to do. Of course, you can do great things with watercolor. Like I said, I'm in love with watercolors, and watercolors have been my fascination ever since I started picking up a brush. But for me, watercolors is also the beginning sketching of a painting for perhaps to move on in onto acrylics, and from acrylics to move on to oils. So my fascination with art and painting goes first with watercolors, and then later on I added the oils and et cetera, et cetera. Right now, like I said, I'm adding the details with the tip of that brush. I just wanted to do the middle part. I also noticed that a lot of people feel like the eyes should go the same way, and they should have about the same size. And don't focus too much on that because every single human being have different characteristics And one of the things is that we're imperfect and we have, but there's always one organ bigger than the other, believe it or not. So each person has an eye that is bigger than the other. So you shouldn't think that you can do both eyes the same size, because I also feel like, you know, aesthetically pleasing people would love to do that better, but really, real world, real people, there's some people are more significant. I feel like some people have more, they're significantly, their eyes are a bit bigger, and some people have different size eyes, but most of us have one eye bigger than the other. That's sort of like the rule of anatomy as well. So I think that I'll have some time to explain one small detail, one small thing before I go, is also, and I think that will also help. If you were to do anatomy and locate the skeleton, like inside of a human being, inside that flesh, that's how we basically add the shadow all over or on top of the face. So every single thing that you see here has a shadow of what's over. So that's the reason why artists focus a lot. And I think the best way to really locate the shadow of that socket or the eye socket is by actually looking at yourself in the mirror and doing that. Another thing that not to be afraid of, you know, jotting down and to put down on the paper what you really see. Don't be afraid of, if you see purple, put purple. If you see blue, put blue down. If you see pink, put it down. That's the color that you see. Because what happens is that it makes no sense sometimes. It doesn't make no sense that I see purple in there, or that I see a hint of black in it, or that I see a hint of yellow or green, but it is actually there. So this, that's what you see, put it down. It will help you tremendously to just get rid of, I feel like we are so used to see, we want to do something pretty, which is okay. But at the same time, it's what's going to help you learn doing something like that. And then later on, if you want to do something pretty and you see purple, but you want it to look pretty and you want to put another color that you think that is more pleasing, you can do it. I think that I will go with know the rules so you can bend the rules type of thing. And that's it for now. I just hope that you guys are enjoying these portraits. It's a very lengthy video. This actually portrait lasted about, this actually sketch. I can't call it a portrait as if yet, because I'm actually practicing for bigger things coming. Actually lasted a whole hour. So I really don't think that it will be okay to really just do a whole thing, a whole hour, and talk about it, even though I would love to do a step-by-step video of what I'm actually doing. I feel like the best way of actually learning is by actually watching. So feel free to connect with me through Twitter or even Facebook. I have, these are the demos that I actually do from a place called, I believe it's Periscope. And I do the videos this way because it's easier to transfer them to YouTube. So you're more than welcome to see me from Twitter and just DM me if you want to. I would love to explain the process with you, even though I try my best to, you know, to take you through the demo as much as I could. I believe that my head is in the way. I'm sorry. So, right now I'm adding the last details, which is some hair here and there, some imperfections, a little bit of shadow. And one thing that you will notice is that the more darker I go, the more complete the portrait looks. And that's a good thing. So here I'm adding the darkest dark to the eyes. And you can see that it looks much, much realistic and much, much better. Even though, of course, we added all of those colors. You can see now it looks like a portrait, more complete. I also added a hint of that same color into the corner of the lips. And I also try my best to do the same thing for the nose. All right, so last but not least is that I like that splashy feeling of watercolor, so I cover it with a piece of paper and I just splash it out with the same background color. I think it looks cool, and also that's part of watercolor to me. Since I didn't have no background color, I thought it was a cool way of doing it. I also added a hint of alcohol for the background. I think it looks good, and I didn't want anything to have no lines in it, so just something simple. And it's also a good idea so you can see how to do this stuff when you get a chance to do watercolor. I think it looks very watercolory, and it actually just makes you want to paint. Before I go, again, thank you so much for watching, for allowing me to show you how to do this. I hope that you learned something. And again, if you like these demos and you like what you see, definitely follow me. I'm hoping to bring you more instructional videos and more demos so you can learn. And I want to be to you a very, very good day.